Respected Swamiji, moderator, eminent panelists, ladies and gentlemen, I wish to thank Sri Vishnu Foundation for giving me this opportunity to speak about social justice and peace. I will talk based on my experience with Hand in Hand. Hand in Hand started as a small NGO out of Kanchipuram in Tamil Nadu. When I joined, there were 3 people. Today, there are about 10,400 people. We work across 18 states in India, and we have also expanded overseas to 10 different countries. Basically, what is the rationale between social justice, peace, and social work? If you look at the UN Deprivation Index, you have the gender divide, you have the digital divide, we have the rich-poor divide. I think all these things are leading to a lot of tension. I worked in South Africa, I worked in Brazil, and I see that sort of an unrest coming even in India. So we have to do something to bridge the rich-poor divide. I think lot of organizations are doing their best, but we have a 1.4 billion population, so it is not enough. I think citizens, government, and voluntary organizations, we should work hand in hand to solve the problems in our country so that everybody gets their basic right and there is peace and joy everywhere. So basically, what do we do at Hand in Hand? We have developed a 5-pillar program based on the UN Deprivation Index. We tackle the various aspects of poverty. We focus on women empowerment and job creation. Child labor elimination is a core program because children are vulnerable, and we work with the mothers of child laborers. Health is also an important issue which needs to be addressed because many poor people at the bottom of the pyramid, they do not have access to basic health facilities. We work in Bihar and Jharkhand, and it is really, really pathetic because we come across every week at least we attend to 4 or 5 children who are malnourished, who weigh only 1.6 kilograms. And even in the case of women, it's really, really pathetic because their husbands go to other states for work, they never come back, and then they are single at the age of 29 and 30 and burdened with managing the entire household with 5 to 6 children. So we focus on health, skill development and technology because that can bridge both. It can bring about an increase in income. It can also bridge the digital divide. We are working a lot in that space. And last, I need not say the importance of environment because we witnessed the floods recently. See, it is not having any, natural calamities affect rich and the poor equally, but poor people, rich people at least can go and stay in hotels. They can make themselves comfortable and then go back to their homes after the floods. But I saw a person crying before the television. He had lost 5 of his buffaloes. He says, my entire life is gone. He had not insured basically, and 350 animals, I'm told, have died in the recent floods. So there is so much of inequality, and so we have to focus on environment. We have to remember all the time our population is very big. We cannot cope unless all of us should be disciplined. Because if somebody watches, we try to put the garbage we have in the dustbin. Otherwise, we just litter. We think somebody else will come and clean. Who will come and clean? It is such a big population. We have to be responsible. So we are in the area of solid waste, plastic, ocean waste management. We employ about 2,000 green friends to clean up the place, to create good models which can be replicated by the government. And also, water conservation is one area where we focus. We work very closely with NABARD and government organizations. So basically, our vision is alleviation of poverty, because poverty is a causal factor for all the reasons. If we talk about child labor, malnourishment. So if we believe strongly if the women are empowered and if they have a job, they are able to take care of themselves and the family. So we believe in an integrated approach because that tackles the different aspects of poverty. For some people, it is a question of access. For some people, it is deprivation. And in India, we come across different models. Each state, it is a different scenario. Tamil Nadu is at some other level. whereas MP is at another level. Punjab, they have lot of resources, but when it comes to women, it is really pathetic because they don't have access to reproductive health and so on. So we designed the program according to the needs of each and every state. And what we have managed to achieve in the last 20 years. And this also has been possible. The previous speaker spoke about Dharma. So even in the context of not-for-profit, our philosophy has been that we have to be extremely, extremely transparent because we are handling public funding. So we have all types of audit, and I'm also running a company, finance company, which is regulated by RBI. Our audit committee of the not-for-profit, I'm literally scared to represent as a managing trustee because they go into each and every line item in the financials, and that is the rigor with which they have trained me because they believe that money which is collected for not-for-profit should be utilized for the right purpose and it has to benefit the people we are serving for. And because of this discipline and the team, we have managed to scale up whatever we have been doing. We have set up about 101 lakh micro enterprises. Micro enterprises are enterprises which provides jobs to others. We see women, they start off with some small enterprise, then with some financial credit, then skill training and digital training, they are able to employ their husbands, which really breaks the gender divide, and also other women. So they are able to employ 3 to 4 women. So we have set up about 100,000 micro enterprises. Across India, we have formed around 4 lakh self-help groups. I think I'm very passionate about self-help groups because women do not get energy, or as a lone person, they find it difficult to speak. But in a group, they get a lot of confidence. They are able to negotiate. The previous speaker and also was listening to some of the previous panel discussion also, which spoke about negotiation, how we get their rights. When we are talking about equity, social justice, I think that is also very important. And in the area of environment, 6,000 hectares, I'm not talking about numbers, just to show what Hand in Hand has achieved, but also to make all the audience understand the scope that is there for a not-for-profit in India. And that is one Hand in Hand or one institution cannot actually meet the requirements of the poor people. And around 300,000 children, we have mainstreamed them into formal schooling. We run 6 residential schools for children out of school, child laborers, and also tribals. We have a package for them. We help them get their lost childhood and then mainstream them into government schools. So basically what I want to emphasize is social justice plus economic growth, because when we talk about equity, unless a person has 3 meals a day, nothing. If you say you have to educate your child, who is going to listen to you? All of you must have watched the TV channels, the way they were screaming this time, because for 3 days they were left without food and water. So I think economic empowerment plays a very, very vital role when we talk about social justice, and only then there can be peace. So what is the rationale of the 5-pillar program and how it addresses today's topic? When it comes to child labor elimination in education, basically children from the poor communities, tribals, they do not have the access. There's always gender disparity. In North, in MP and Rajasthan, when a girl attains puberty, they stop them from schooling, because in Bihar, we have provided bicycles. They say they have to walk for nearly 4 hours a day. So during winter, parents are very scared. So they stop them. We run some transit school child learning centers to help them cope with government exams. But that's the least we can do, but there is a lot of gender disparity. And even quality. After COVID, the educational outcomes, you know, of the school, Asim Premji Foundation, every year they publish. Lot of work has to be done in that space. Even in Tamil Nadu, it is my home state, so I feel it's really pathetic. Fifth standard child is not able to read few sentences in Tamil or even do maths. So I think gender, we have to do a lot in improving the quality of education. So how will that ensure justice? by involving the community through gender mainstreaming and through teacher training. We have adopted around 50 schools. We are working in school strengthening program so as to make them realize how they can improve the quality of education. In the area of skill development, across the country we see unemployment, there is skill gap, there is also economic inequality. And to ensure justice, we can invest in skill training, and that too it should be through a rigorous process. Otherwise, people take everything for granted. Anything which is given for free, nobody attends the skill training, even though government is spending crores and crores for skill training. So there should be a rigorous process for selection and then linking them with some corporate so that they immediately get employment. And microfinance is also necessary for first generation entrepreneurs, because it is very difficult to get funding from banks. They have their own very stringent due diligence, and they will not fund the first generation entrepreneurs. And livelihood promotion is very essential to actually get people out of poverty. When it comes to women empowerment and job creation, what are the challenges people face now? Gender-based violence, it has gone up in Tamil Nadu because of drinking habit. It was only drinking 5 years before. Now they are also into drugs. And last week I saw in Virudhunagar, three government school students have attacked the teacher for enforcing discipline. And women and self-help groups in Kanchipuram, they tell me a six-year-old boy is having a knife because they said you cannot have drugs. He was going to attack self-help group women. It's become so pathetic, it is so rampant. So all these things, I think as citizens, we should, at least I keep talking about it. I know I cannot make a huge change, but wherever it is possible, we try to tell them that this is not good for you. And at least about 500 to 600 people we have managed to change in those villages. They have taken a resolution that they will not drink. So I think it has to start somewhere. So advocacy and awareness will play a great role in bringing about economic empowerment. When you talk about public health, because we have hospitals, but access is a problem, and awareness also. People go to the hospital in the last minute. They cannot fill up any form. So that golden hour is lost. We are running help desks in 7 government hospitals. Per day, we are able to help nearly 10,000 people, because illiterate people who come to the hospital in the last minute. And another area we focus is sanitation. So ensuring justice, what are the various initiatives? Health camps, health education, community health workers. We try to empower them so that they can work with the government systems, and we can reach out to more people. Regarding environmental sustainability, challenges are climate change impact, resource depletion, and lack of awareness. So we work a lot in advocacy, disaster preparedness, and livelihood promotion. Even out of waste, so many things are possible, but people have to be trained. So basically, to align with today's topic, I feel we start with the women and individual empowerment. Through the individuals and the self-help groups, we empower the community. And once the community is empowered, it results in sustained development. And for that, peace and social justice have to be ingrained into whatever we do. It is easy to speak just to some. I thought I'll take you through some case studies. It's about Naseem Rafiq in Maharashtra. Because one income is not enough. So she had the aspiration. We trained her not only in tailoring, but also digital marketing. She's able to procure orders. And now with the increase in income, they're able to educate the children. They've come out of poverty. Similarly, when talking about community empowerment, already I said, like as a group, people feel empowered, and it is applicable more to women because they feel their voice is getting heard. And I was very happy when they said, together as a group, they are able to lobby with government and get a lot of things for themselves and for the community. We have an apex organization of the self-help groups called CLNs. We are promoting it pan-India so that it can act as an interface between the individual citizens and the communities. Self-sustainability, because economic empowerment leads to development. This is a case study in Thiruvannamalai. they managed to get a road which is worth about 95 lakhs. The men were not able to do. A group of women, they were able to lobby with the collector and they have got it done. And about nearly, I would say, 30% of our women have got elected as Panchayat Raj presidents, and they are also carrying out development activities wherever they are. So once again, I wish to thank Sri Vishnu Foundation for giving me this opportunity to speak about Hand in Hand and how we are trying to promote peace and justice and whatever we do. Thank you, everyone.